Establishment of four, please. Let's get Anthony's few moments to join us.
That's it.
Good morning, everyone. We get started. Welcome to the Los Angeles Homeless Authority Commission meeting. Today is Friday, October 27th. This meeting is being recorded. Commissioner Horvath?
Here.
Commissioner Bull?
Here.
Commissioner Barker?
Here.
Commissioner Bass?
Here.
Commissioner Kinshaw?
Here.
Commissioner McMorrin?
Here.
Commissioner Morrow? Commissioner Perez? Commissioner Santos? We have quorum.
Thank you very much. The mics are a little bit soft, so if we can just make sure to speak into the mics as we're giving direction today, that would be great. And we will turn it to our CEO for land acknowledgement. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and good morning. The Los Angeles Continuum of Care and LASA acknowledge our presence and work on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Gabrielino, Hangwa, Keech, Bernardino, Tatakbiem, and the Chumash peoples. LASA acknowledges the native peoples of this land as the land caretakers of our region. We acknowledge that homelessness did not exist before colonization of this land, genocide, and governmental policies of erasure and land and wealth dispossession. We express our deep gratitude for the ancestors, elders, and protectors past, present, and emerging who stored this land.
Thank you very much. And now we'll turn to item two, to review and approve the minutes from the special commission meeting held Friday, September 29th, 2023. Are there any changes, corrections, additions? If not, I'd entertain a motion.
I would move approval.
Second.
All right.
Commissioner Horvath?
Aye.
Commissioner Gould?
Aye.
Commissioner Barker?
Aye.
Commissioner Bass?
Aye.
Commissioner Chinchilla?
Aye.
Commissioner McMorrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Saunders?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you very much. And we'll now turn to our consent agenda, which is item three. There are several items under the headline. We will be removing item 3.1A from consent. So we will consider that item separate from the consent agenda. So the consent calendar will include 3.1, 3.2, 3.2A, 3.3, 3.4, Are there any questions? Any comments? If not, I'd entertain a motion on our consent agenda.
I'll move it.
A second.
So motion and a second.
Commissioner Horvath?
Aye.
Commissioner Fuller?
Aye.
Commissioner Barker?
Aye.
Commissioner Bass?
Aye.
Commissioner Chinchilla?
Aye.
Commissioner McMorrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Saunders?
Aye.
The motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. And now we'll consider item 3.1A separately. I believe one of our commissioners has to recuse from that item. So we'll now hear item 3.1A.
Good morning, commissioners, colleagues, members of the public. I'm Jacqueline Montgomery, Associate Director of Contracts and Procurement. So item number 3.1A, there's been an adjustment to the agenda. We have added additional funding. The additional funding added to the authorization table provides funds to Highland Gardens under the Alliance Settlement Agreement Program. The funding amount has been updated to reflect the new amounts that were shared with LASA on October 23rd.
And is this part of, when you say it's part of the Alliance Settlement Agreement, is it part of city, county, or the previous Alliance Settlement?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Is it the city's a settlement agreement with Alliance, the county's settlement agreement, or the previous Alliance meeting?
This is with the city. The funds are through the Los Angeles Housing Department.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions on this item? If not, I'd entertain a motion on 3.1A.
I'll move approval.
Second.
Right. We have a motion and a second.
Commissioner Horvath?
Aye.
Commissioner Bloom?
Aye.
Commissioner Barker? Commissioner Bass? Commissioner McMorrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Morrow?
Perez, they had the wrong name on
that. Yeah.
Commissioner Perez?
Aye.
Commissioner Saunders?
Aye.
The motion passes unanimously.
All right, thank you. And we'll now move on to item four, which is our executive leadership report. We'll turn it to our CEO.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for being here today. Dr. Felicia Adams Keller, CEO of LASA. And I welcome, as you already did, Chair Horvath, all of our new commissioners, Mayor Bass and Supervisor Carter. Today is absolutely historic for LASA. The city led by Mayor Bass and our county led by the Board of Supervisors made a commitment to lock arms to address the crisis of homelessness. We see that here today with so many city, county, and smaller city representatives lock arms and here in the same space. So glad when I joined LASA, I had no idea you'd be joining me as well. We must have alignment, and we know that, across the city and the county, shared goals and agreed upon direction. And I know by having our key leaders and elected officials on LASA's commission, we're moving in that direction. I want to start my report by sharing an example of this alignment, highlighting how when we come together across all sectors and jurisdictions, we see amazing results. On Tuesday, October 24th, a joint effort took place between the mayor's office, LA City Council Districts 5 and 11, the city of Culver City, county support through the CEO's Homeless Initiative, Supervisor Districts 2 and 3, LASA, I'm not done, First to Serve, St. Joseph Center, to address a historical encampment located at the 405 and the underpass Venice Boulevard, also called Venice and Globe. In a matter of hours, led by Inside Safe teams mobilized to connect people experiencing homelessness in this encampment to interim housing, we changed lives. LASA outreach teams, supported by the mayor's office, Inside Safe team, Culver City, and the county, worked together successfully. And in just 1.5 days, we moved almost 60 individuals indoors. This particular location has one of the most vulnerable and entrenched encampments in our county. With heavy substance use and criminal activity, this was not a safe place for those living there or for those who served. This encampment was a perfect example of the complexity of our homeless sector as it crossed multiple jurisdictions, as I said before, the city of Culver City, supervisor districts, and the like. And then on the city side, it crossed City 5 and City 11. All partners came together to plan this effort in the last few weeks and worked tirelessly to make it successful. I want to highlight the good work of the mayor's office for leading this Inside Safe effort, and Anita Wells, the director of the homeless work of Inside Safe, CD 11 and Councilmember Park, CD 5 and Councilmember Yaroslavsky, Culver City, and the county led by Carter Hubley's team at the Homeless Initiative, and our service providers, as I mentioned before, St. Joseph's Center and First to Serve. Together, one of the most entrenched encampments was addressed, and all of those folks have a new lease on life and a path forward. We're continuing to see great progress on all of our encampment resolution efforts, and we are so pleased that folks are responding and we've not had arrests and lives are being changed. So I want to give a little bit of an update on Inside Safe. Two more successful efforts took place in the last month in Inside Safe, resulting in over 100 people experiencing homelessness, moving indoors and being placed in housing. For LASA's role, it was finding housing for those not in the original by name list in the database. Those are the folks that tend to stay, to turn up and to show up day of. And we still are committed to providing those services. And so that's an area where LASA is able to help. The first site was Balboa in Devonshire, and there were 35 placements. That was spot 2, council, and council district 12, and SD3. Then at the Virgil Middle School and Chateau Park, there were 114 placements. That was spot 4, CD1, CD10, CD13, and SD2. Upcoming, we have 4 efforts in the planning stage and scheduled to launch in the next month. For Pathway Home, in coordination with the county, the Hawthorne effort took place this week on 1026 SD2, spot 8, and 6 people went indoors. For Loss's role, we did the pre-assessment of the encampment, the mapping and zoning, coordination of the by-name list, data entry, and support at the motels for program enrollment. On the county side, there are 3 efforts coming up in the planning stage, and we're very excited about the work both the city and county. In terms of CS redesign and the KPI presentation that you will hear today, I want to tell you about 3 main things to keep in mind. First, our system key performance indicators for FY22-23 will be addressed. LASA utilizes these high-level indicators to track our system-wide performance. They allow us to see how many and the percentage of people moving off the street into interim housing and our throughput from interim to permanent housing. These are a collaborative effort with the California Policy Lab, who provides us vital support in ensuring we have these quarterly reported metrics. And we know this has been an area of struggle, and we are improving in that regard. We keep you updated. However, as this data will show, you're currently reducing the unsheltered homelessness, but they are not necessarily, you will see a path forward in every way. I believe, though, that LASA and our city and county partners must next establish goals that align. So while you'll see our progress, what I want to see is aligned goals so that we're setting them and we are reaching those goals collectively. One thing that you will see, our averages in throughput, which I think are sitting around 17%. And for LASA, internally, we're grappling with the goal of getting 25%. And of course, we believe the system collectively should be setting those goals and reaching them. Second, we will be presenting on the coordinated entry system redesign that LASA has been working on for the past few years. And thanks to the leadership of Mayor Bass, Homeless Initiative and county departments, and moving us forward and improving the system. LASA is bringing this to scale, and we are really leaning on our lessons learned in that regard. CES, for some of you may already know this, was created 10 years ago to more equitably distribute resources across the county and to ensure that there was no wrong door when it came to assessing housing. Abby, our new CPO, will speak more on the need for CES from a federal perspective. But just to note, previously in LA, we had a very disjointed and inequitable system where some of the regions received more funding than areas with more entrenched poverty and higher rates of homelessness. We also lacked a centralized method of referring people to services. And finally, we saw that many people were being prioritized for valuable and costly resources like permanent supportive housing who were not the most acute. The impact left those most vulnerable on the streets, and we're still dealing with that to this day. CES critically helped balance our funding across the system. It created a vulnerability index to assess individuals' acuity and established a matching system so we could begin to more appropriately match housing and resources. It also ensured collaboration across continuum of care as we utilize HMIS to track individuals from provider to provider with the goal of preventing people from falling through the cracks and duplicating resources as well. However, we created this without the flexibility, the nimbleness, and I would say the sensitivity to the challenges that emerge. And often as a system, we just weren't transparent about the challenges we're facing and the difficulties. One area was racial bias in the vulnerability survey and an overly complicated and inefficient system of matching people to permanent supportive housing, which created a lot of delays. Thanks to the great work that has been underway at LASA for the past few years and the creation of the Housing Central Command with the help of Amy Perkins, our own, we have made tremendous progress in addressing the shortcomings that we've seen along the way. Today, we will elaborate on the new CES and provide you all the details on what we changed and the preliminary data we see that is showing some promising results. But we are also still really grappling with some challenges that we want to be very clear about. Finally, we are presenting on safe parking. As a follow-up from the last commission meeting on the RFP being canceled, we wanted to provide you all with an update on how this is still moving forward. We also want to give you a look at safe parking program across the county. We plan to dive further into the efficacy of safe parking at a later date. But today we want to give you a summary of the current utilization of resources. I believe this is a valuable topic, and I hope this presentation begins a conversation and one we must continue to ensure our programs are effective in addressing the current need. I also want to make you aware that as of October 2023, 6 community listening sessions have been held across the SPA by LASA team, and I've been there to present directly on our initiatives and to allow people to share their concerns and the challenges that they're facing. We were in SPAs 2, 3, 4, 6, and 7, and have plans to get to the rest. We're going to give you each of these a list of the sessions coming up so you can track those and you can join me if you're able. And we want to make sure that we get your feedback. Some of the things that we've already heard from our groups is that they want more face-to-face time with folks at LASA. And they want to also make sure that they understand how the resources are invested. And we also saw that a lot of the systems and collaborative efforts stalled during COVID need to come back to fruition and back, you know, be rejuvenated. And sometimes it's just being in that space and someone says, well, we don't know what's happening. And someone will say, well, we still meet, but people stopped coming or we were meeting on Zoom. And so in some ways we're just getting people back together, which is so important. In terms of funding requests, we are now beginning the funding process with our city and county stakeholders for next fiscal year. We're actively working with the City of LA and the Homeless Initiative at the County CEO office. Together, we are committed to funding what works, and this may require shifts in the current fiscal year. We're also grappling with how we ensure we are spending down our contracts and how we increase our rates that reflect more of full costs and higher wage issues to make our providers whole. While we are just beginning these funding requests, I want to make sure you're all included and fully understand this process. So we'll be getting your input in previous in future presentations and take the feedback we received from you previously to make sure we're moving forward together. Invoicing. I want to give you an update on some pain points for LASA. The time it takes for us to pay providers has often been an issue. While this could have taken over months and months, we have worked very hard in a short period of time to cut some of the funding time delays down. The average time it's taking now for invoices is decreasing. In July, it was 20 days. In August, it was 17 days, and now we stand at 14 days, which, as I recall, was a goal we all set when Measure H launched. This is showing great improvement. However, as many of you have heard, there are still providers and others who are waiting for payment, and we will do everything we can to continue this average so that everyone has experienced this increased pace of us paying out. Master leasing, finally, an update on master leasing is needed. With the support from CEOHI, we rolled out the master leasing program, and we thank commissioners for your support. To date, we have secured about 5 buildings for a total of 110 units. Our goal is to still reach 800 units by the end of the fiscal year. I think with that, I will turn it back over to the chair.
Thank you, Madam CEO. And it certainly is a new day on our commission. We welcome our new commissioners. Thank you for joining us. The first mayor, I think, in history to join the LASA Commission herself. I think that you're the first herself, too. So I think there's something about that. And I just really appreciate the hands-on approach and partnership that you have offered. And Supervisor Barker, I think it's so clear. It says a lot that you have chosen to appoint yourself, taking the issue of homelessness seriously and investing personal accountability into this issue. I just welcome you both. But I also want to be clear that every single member of this commission brings valuable experience. We have elected leaders from small cities who represent that perspective. We have service providers represented and lived experience represented. Every single commissioner contributes meaningfully to this discussion. So it takes all of us. I think what's different is the attention being paid to the work that's done in this meeting room. It's the first time I've been here with cameras, I will say that. This is the number one issue for Angeleno. So people are paying attention now to where the work is being done. And I think that is critical. We are clear about the collaboration that we're doing in the region, exemplified by this week's Inside Safe action. All of those partners that you listed are a demonstration that we are all in, we are all focused, we are all working together, and that's what the public expects us to be doing. So thank you for your report. Are there any comments or questions about the report? Madam Mayor.
First of all, it is a pleasure to be here. I'm very excited about it and excited about, one, learning more about LASA in general, but especially LASA from this perspective and working with my colleagues here. I'm very excited about it. Thank you, Madam CEO, for your report. I wanted to add something that I'm not sure you know, because I just learned this the other day. I was at Virgil Middle School because that was also another really awful encampment. The kids, they couldn't walk up the sidewalk, and they couldn't walk in the street near the sidewalk. They had to walk in the middle of the street because the encampment flowed all the way over. So I was there with the superintendent, and he told me that in the beginning of the school year in January, there were 103 schools with encampments. Do you know it's down 50%? And he attributed it to our efforts. Now, I know that we have done some Inside Safe near schools and all, Pathway Home also has done some. But I certainly know we haven't done that many. And so what that means to me, just like when you talked about the encampment this week, which was a very complicated one, because of all of those jurisdictions, but it felt wonderful that everybody just wasn't even a problem because we had built up this history of working together. But, you know, you mentioned the people that walk up, the by name list and the people who are not on that list, that our experience has been when we're getting ready to resolve an encampment, unhoused people from other areas find out about it and they come up and want to be housed. And so I know that that's why some of the encampments have gone away near schools where we weren't there, or tents have come down where we weren't there. So even though it presents a challenge to us on move-in day, because we might not have enough rooms, it's a really good problem to have that people are hearing about what's going on and wanting to be housed. So you need to put that 50% in your report and claim it.
I will. I love that. And part of this is that, you know, there's multidisciplinary teams funded through the Department of Health Services through Measure H that are across the county. And, you know, there's been some increased teams in the last year. And those outreach teams every day engage people in encampments. So while we're doing some of these other efforts, it's still happening. And I think while people are starting to get this sense of, oh, this is a housing effort,
right.
I think they're responding to the outreach teams in a slightly different way, or in a major different way, really major way that is a departure. And I think the outreach teams having resources in hand,
right,
as we are in our larger Pathway Home and Inside Safe, is also making a huge difference.
Any other comments or questions for our CEO? We do have speakers. Hold on.
Good morning, Abigail Prof. You're welcome to speak.
Anybody can speak here? Can anybody speak here?
Mm-hmm. Abigail, can you please unmute yourself? Abigail Prof, you're welcome to speak. Can you please unmute yourself? Suzette Shaw, you can go ahead and speak.
Good morning, commissioners, and welcome Mayor Bass, as well as Commissioner, or can you hear me? Welcome Mayor Bass, as well as Supervisor Barger. We're so glad that you are joining this body. I would also, as a Skid Row community member, as an advocate and expert, as it relates to homelessness and homelessness in my community of unaccompanied single adult women, of the growing number of Black people and aging population, I would just urge the commission as a body to bring equity to the commission board as it relates to a lived experience, lived expertise. I feel that, you know, when you all just appoint one person to a body amongst yourselves, I think that, you know, you're it kind of establishes or sends a message that you feel that there's one perspective, a voice, and one demographic, rather than understanding that we are a continuum. There's issues across the board. The urgencies going on in Skid Row are, or could be further elevated and amplified. And I, as a COC board member and chair, I ask that you bring equity to the commission board with those of us with lived experience and lived expertise. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Aaron Freeman, you're welcome to speak.
Hi, thank you. Well, it's nice to see the bigwigs rolling up their sleeves. I mean, I really do appreciate it. So that's the good news. You know, I'm so bereft about CES in general, because it's, I know it's trying to make sense of all these confusing coordinates, but I think keeping your eye on the task at hand is great. And I like the speech about how, you know, just doing it is attracting the attention of other groups who are also then getting involved in doing it. So that's good. Safe parking is a no-brainer. The more that that can be, you know, relaxed into places where it's not disturbing neighbors, the easier. That's a great way to get someone off the street. Just, you need to provide a shower. When I looked at it closely, it was horrifying because everything was confusing and it seemed like most of the money was going in the wrong direction. But keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. Next speaker, please.
Peggy Lee Kennedy, you're welcome to speak.
Hi, Peggy Lee Kennedy, Venice Justice Committee. You know, my big question is, where is LASA with recommending 24-hour, 7-day-a-week safe parking for oversized vehicles? We did a survey, an RV survey in September. 40 RV residents were surveyed, 30 in Venice, 10 out of Playa del Rey and Mar Vista. Out of that, 26 of the 40, that's 65%, said they wanted safe parking with access to, you know, connection to housing. It seems like a really simple solution to me, and I'm wondering where LASA is on trying to get this funding for such a thing and expanding it, because it's more and more people are ending up in vehicles, and that's really important. Also, I want to say that 21 of the 40 RV residents we surveyed identified as disabled. That's 52.5% of the people, and it seemed kind of low to me but that's still a lot of disabled people. So I can't imagine why we aren't moving forward with this. The City of LA CAO report came out recommending it, and we really should push for funding and expansion of it. And I just want to know where we are with safe parking for large vehicles 24/7. Thank you.
Thank you. And if you continue to listen to our meeting, item 7 is a safe parking report. You might be interested in that discussion. Next speaker, please.
David Presents, you're welcome to speak. David Presents, you're welcome to speak.
I'm sorry, is that David Proloth? Here we go. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Mayor Bass. Good to see you, Supervisor Barger. My name is David Prentice. I am the CEO of the Midnight Mission in downtown Los Angeles. As some of you know, the Midnight Mission has been serving people experiencing homelessness now in Skid Row for 109 years. And as you're well aware of, we are the epicenter of street homelessness. I was a little shocked that LASA released an RFP with a per night bed rate of $110 when the Midnight Mission has an unchanged per bed night rate of only $40. We have had the same rate for 6 years in spite of asking for an increase to keep up with spiraling costs. You won't give us more funding and you won't let us serve fewer people. We get paid roughly $1.7 million to keep 150 interim housing beds filled every night when it cost us, are you ready for this, about $2.5 million to cover our cost for those 150 beds. Something has got to change, and I would ask that you would please take this to discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
We have no further speakers.
We have one person here who will join us, Lisa Hope. You have 2 minutes to speak. Come up to the microphone, please.
My name is Lisa Hope. I'm currently now living at the Cecil Hotel, the old Cecil Hotel. I'm working with PATH, City Account Without PATH. I'm about to be back in a tent, basically. And you have us over there. There's one elevator, and for there's no buttons. There's no. I'm about to be back in a tent, and my housing Section 8 was kicked back because there was no vouchers. They told me to find somebody I could live with for a year, because there's no more vouchers for a one bedroom or a studio. So I wanted to know how do I get help? Because nobody's helping me. I'm about to be back in a tent.
Very clear, and we don't want that. Can someone from LASA staff please connect with Ms. Hope so we can understand? Right back in the corner there, that gentleman raising his hand will connect with you.
I'm sorry.
No apology necessary. This is exactly what we want to do, is help you. All right. If there are no more speakers, we'll move on to item 5, which... Just a reminder, if somebody wants to speak on any item, we do have speaker slips. If you fill it out and indicate which item on which you'd like to speak, there's also a public participation section, which is item 12 at the end of the meeting, if the thing that you would like to speak on is not currently on today's agenda. We have more. Do we have anyone else on this item? Yes.
Jacqueline Grant just addressed one thing about the bed rate issue. That's something that we can address very quickly.
Sure. Let's make it quick, because normally we don't want to do a back and forth, but we can agendize it for further discussion. But if you'd like to address something quickly,
very quickly.
Thank you so much. Good morning. My name is Jacqueline Grant. I'm the director of the Interim Housing Department at LASA. Thank you. Yes, we have been hearing the concern from providers around the cost of operating interim housing, and take those concerns very seriously. In partnership with the county homeless initiative, and also in conversation with the City of Los Angeles, LASA is looking at the reimbursement rates that we utilize for interim housing programs.
We've been working with a consultant over the last year to understand what those true costs are, and then to be able to work alongside our community partners to determine if they're only an adjustment to those rates. That work is actively underway, and we are looking forward to bringing an update to the commission at a very near upcoming meeting.
Great. So we'll agendize that for further discussion and making sure that we're addressing that concern.
Thank you.
We'll now move on to item 5, which is a report on adult system key performance indicators.
Good morning, commissioners. My name is Emily Montgomery. I am the deputy CIO at LASA. And today I will be presenting system KPIs on the adult system. Our housing system is introducing a new level of transparency and accountability for our work through key performance indicators, a shared set of metrics to measure and improve how we help our unhoused neighbors. Data is powerful and visibility drives change. Other regions like Houston have moved the needle of homelessness through collaboration and shared goals. This shared view of system-wide data will give us the tools and pinpoint the weak spots in our system and implement targeted improvements. LASA, the city, and the county have measured performance across multiple metrics and dashboards, many of which are mandated to cover only certain city, county, state, and federal funding streams and projects simultaneously. This has given us a snapshot of specific programs at a micro level, but an incomplete picture of how our overall system works. Now, thanks to a visionary multi-year investment from the Conrad and Hilton Foundation and the partnership of the California Policy Lab and dozens of government agencies and nonprofit providers across LA County, we operate our rehousing system, are working together to align how we measure our effectiveness. Next slide. The agenda for today, first we will begin with humanizing the data we share. We will be sharing two stories of people experiencing homelessness with you. Second, we will provide background information on the system's key performance indicators, followed by data on the top line matrix, street outreach, interim housing, and time-limited subsidies. Next slide. You can go to the next one. Thank you. Every data point we share today is someone's story, and every story is a data point. We want to make sure we humanize the data. Therefore, we want to highlight and share Ms. Mary's story with you. She was among the first recipients to move into the Baldwin Tiny Home Village, and now lives in an apartment thanks to our emergency housing vouchers. Next slide. Meet Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell was forced to move away from home and live on the streets for 20 years. LASA Homeless Engagement Team, PET, developed a rapport with him over 2 years and connected him to an emergency housing voucher, which provided him with rental assistance. Mr. Mitchell got an apartment and is now housed for the first time in decades. Next slide. You can go to the next one. As the rehousing system lead, LASA is coordinating and the introduction of KPIs as part of our new strategic vision under the leadership of Dr. Adams Callum for our system. Our overall goal is to reduce unsheltered homelessness by increasing the speed and volume of people entering permanent housing and increase successful movement from outreach to shelter, from outreach to shelter to housing, and from outreach directly into permanent housing. KPIs help us equip data-driven decision-making by collecting, analyzing, and sharing regional data to track our progress towards shared goals, ultimately giving us a clear path as a system. Next slide. Data is powerful and visibility again drives change. Measure how people and families move through the system to permanent housing. Align funders and define system performance without regarding to funding source or jurisdiction. Help us understand how people from different demographic groups move through the system so that we can ensure equity. Share consistent outcomes publicly and hold ourselves accountable over time by setting matrix. Equip decision and equip us with decision making. Next slide. The KPI aim is to improve how our region rehouses our unhoused neighbors in four key areas. Connect individuals living on the street to interim housing. Better prepare interim housing participants for permanent housing placements. Increase the number of people moving from interim housing to permanent housing. Reduce the time someone system entry to permanent housing placement. The KPI system timeline depicts the historical development of the KPI work that we embodied last year. Here's what we've done so far, and here's where we're going. On September 23rd of 2022, LASA released the first performance matrix, a rough baseline view of our system performance. Next, we spent several months working with system partners to improve data quality by optimizing how data is collected and shared to ensure that we have the most accurate baseline possible to measure from. These system KPIs measure how system supports people in moving from unsheltered homelessness to permanent housing by population, our adults, youth, and families. LASA's posting quarterly data on the throughput from street outreach to interim housing to time-limited subsidies for each population. Once again, this data is pulled from HMIS, the data we're presenting today. The system KPIs do not include data or other databases from outside of HMIS. Just for clarity, all of the system KPI data is out of our HMIS system. Next slide, please. What does the KPI look like in action? To demonstrate how we use KPIs in action, we use the data to track performance and publish our KPI data quarterly and annually. We also share the data at service planning area meetings with key stakeholders. Next slide. E-data is pulled from HMIS, as noted in Clarity. PSH data is limited because our HMIS system do not collect the data. However, the great news, by November 1st, due to AB 977, we will be collecting a lot more data in HMIS from our other county partner systems. Next slide. We are sharing with you the top line matrix for the adult system, the throughput from outreach to interim housing, throughput from interim housing to permanent housing, individuals housed by time limit subsidy programs, and returns to homelessness. The system KPIs are analyzed by quarter and fiscal year. These two types of analysis help us understand how we are moving clients through the system in short times, every 3 months and quarterly, and fiscal year, which is a longer time period. Since 73% of people experiencing homelessness in Los Angeles are unsheltered, a strong, cohesive, and full geographic coverage outreach system is critical. 240 outreach teams of more than 850 serve Los Angeles County, 4,083 square miles. LASA's 93 head teams work closely with 70 DHS-funded multidisciplinary teams, DMH home teams, who support the gravely disabled, and other generalist teams, such as encampment resolution teams, including Inside Safe and Pathway to Home. Outreach teams are coordinated by service planning areas with outreach coordinators in each region. Next slide.
On those numbers that you just gave, because they're not on the list, how many did you say on the outreach teams? Is that inclusive of all outreach teams generally?
Yes, or
is
all,
not just us.
Yes.
How many people? Did you say 850?
850 serve Los Angeles County, the 4,083 square miles. So it's not just lots of pet teams, it's other teams. So we're averaging about a population of 850 individuals are helping doing outreach throughout the county of Los Angeles. And I can quantify that number.
It'd be great. And just for us, you know, to know that's always one of those, been one of the biggest issues, like where what are the nonprofits that are doing that and where they kind of located so we have a picture of it. Thank you.
This slide visualized the number of individuals served by outreach programs by quarter and the number of people throughput in interim housing. We can see there is an increase in quarter three of fiscal year 22-23 in the number and the rate of people that were connected to interim housing. This is attributed to the encampment resolution efforts with Inside Safe by the way of the state of emergency declaration by our city and county leaders. The following Q4 reported a highest number of enrollments of street outreach programs. Next slide. The next graph compares the throughput rates of interim housing for fiscal year 21-22, which is July 1st, 2021, through June 30th of 2022, and fiscal year 2022-2023, which is July 1st of 2022, through June 30th of 2023 for each subpopulation. Our Black, Latino, and White individuals account for more than 90% of the total population. There is no change in the throughput rate of each year. However, we can see that Hispanic Latino population is slightly under the average of 17%. Nevertheless, we are not seeing a major difference across these three populations, given their overall prevalence of the overall prevalence in street outreach programs. We can see that there are some variations in the level of deviations in the throughput rate for the smallest of populations. But again, keep in mind that each of these populations is reporting less than 625 individuals served, which is much smaller population size than our Black, Latino, and White subpopulations. The smaller size may exacerbate the smaller group's data fluctuations. So again, it's less than 625 individuals. So the graph will show the fluctuation may appear higher. Next slide, please.
I think before we move to interim, I just think connecting the dots. I mean, it's pretty easy to say it's 800 or so outreach teams and 17% throughput. Connecting the dots to say, what is outreach and engagement about?
Right.
Is it about outreach engagement or is it about resolving homelessness? What I think we're talking about is the only way that number of throughput is going to increase to 25% or more is it's about resolving homelessness, not just engagement. And I will tell you, I think some of you know, is that around Measure H, the main goal was that every single person on the street had someone who had connected to them. That's why you saw the huge proliferation of outreach, because it was about every single person had someone that knew their name, they were by name lists and so forth. That's why we're here in this moment to pivot, to say we had that investment, we did that level of engagement, and what do we need to do today? Now it needs to be much more targeted and about resolving homelessness, but again, without adequate resources. When an outreach team is out there without a resource in hand, they give them what they have, right? So that's what we're here to talk about.
So before we go on to our next section, do we have questions about outreach? Because I know we're going to get into a lot as we go through the presentation. So maybe I'll stop it here to ask questions about outreach.
Can I just ask you?
Supervisor Barker.
So I was talking to the mayor and I said, you know, I feel like it's a little fragmented. So what would help me is a list of all the outreach teams, where they're located, how that is decided. Because I know that in my district, we fund separate, we work with MOCSEP. But I don't know, I just want to get a clear understanding in terms of how the outreach is done. And to that point, I think it's important to have a standard of metrics that shows exactly what the goal is, because to your point, the goal is to get them out.
Yes.
And I sometimes I get lost in translation.
Yes, I was just conferring with Sheree Tordoff, who heads Measure H or HI. Up to this point, the contracts for the multidisciplinary teams has been by SPA and has been based on the homeless camp.
So where the need is where you have more outreach teams, where that number of unsheltered is what's driving where you see the teams. And we can provide, because I think it would be very helpful, to provide a city county map of how it's all laid out. But what you've all heard along the way, and maybe even for me, is it time to assess that? How many teams, where they are, and what are the gaps? I think you're starting to see more specialized teams from the county departments because we're seeing the need so great around severe mental illness and so forth. So anyway, I don't want to prolong it.
To follow up on that though, I mean, I was going to say that one of the things that you talked about was lack of centralized way to track housing. I think that goes hand in hand with what we're talking about.
Right.
So
I think it's been by SPA, and it's been certainly driven by geographic sensitivity to needs and what's happening in a jurisdiction. I think now we're saying, are we finding something that should be more centralized and standardized around the work, and more than anything, resources in hand for those teams.
Any other questions on outreach?
Yeah, I just wanted to, you could get back to me with this, but in looking at it historically, what was the point of what you said about Measure H, meaning that the goal was that there'd be some engagement? Why? I mean, if there's some document, I don't understand that. And
part of it was enumerating the need. It gets back to vulnerability index. It gets back to the by name list. It was more who's out there, what is their level of need, and what is the scope of the problem for a bunch of us. It was worrisome initially that we would be outreaching and we didn't have anything hand in hand to resolve the crisis. And I think what we're doing now in this monumental space is the county and the city are saying, pair resources with the engagement. And that's going to cause us to make some different decisions about how we do this work.
Earlier in the slides, you list the people that were housed and how many stayed and all of that. Somewhere in there, I'd like to know, do we analyze why they became unhoused to begin with? What type of services were offered so that we know where they are, they go into permanent, but you know, why were they originally there and what happens in them during the interim? And frankly, when they go into permanent supportive, what does that mean? If it's an emergency housing voucher and they're just there for how long? Two years? How long are you there with an emergency housing voucher forever?
I mean,
that's
right.
Federal mental
subsidies.
Yeah,
they've been ongoing. Yeah. And some of that is still in this presentation. So I want to make sure we get through outreach. That's outreach.
Yeah.
We can focus on that and then we'll get on. No, you're okay. Anything about outreach?
Yes. As we talked about, we asked that 850 before, where they are and barriers, I think, to that we know on the outreach workers. So to be able to find out from the outreach workers, well, here, it's not only clearly that we need them and have places to go for that interim housing, but just to know where the other barriers are in, do you need more mental health workers in those teams? Do you, you know, and how those were, as you say, allocated in those different groups. So that would just be where those barriers are that we can then address when the outreach workers are literally there and talking.
And just to add to the previous request, it would be great to understand how the multidisciplinary teams and the specialty outreach teams, how they're being targeted. So what measures are we looking at and to deploy these teams and where are they going? And then the other comment that I wanted to make is that I really appreciate your reframing of outreach. And is it just touching like touch point or is it really helping someone get to permanent housing?
Yeah.
And I think that one of the things that we could consider is, you know, the getting information out so that light touch, could it be done in other ways? Can it be done through media communications? Can it be done through working with community-based partners that make sure that they're disseminating information regarding how to access services? Because I think that piece is still important, right? But I understand why that piece would be a lighter touch. So maybe there are other ways that we can do that that's more effective and really maximizing resources and time, and then thinking about the outreach piece, as you were saying, Dr. Adams, about it really being about working with folks. And then just really quickly, just because I'm a bit of a stickler for data presentation, wanted to make a comment on slide 42, what would be really helpful to have before that slide would be a sense of how many vouchers are going to each group. Because when we look at the data, it's as you're, I think you tried to do this with a less than 600 note, but when you look at the data, it can be really difficult to conceptualize what it means unless you have an understanding of how many folks are getting the voucher. So for instance, if we're looking at the white population, is it 800? Oh, sorry, not voucher, but is it 800 people getting to permanent placement? And so that would really help in terms of just conceptualizing. And then really quickly on slide 41, I would recommend maybe doing away with the line because it kind of confused me. And I know that the percentages are meant to represent the connected to interim hospital.
Thank you. Any other questions on outreach?
Yes. Just one additional comment with regard to the outreach teams. It's also looking at the different striations of the outreach teams. So I know there's DHS, there's Lhasa Head, but also within service providers, the role that they play, as well as access centers and how they factor into the work that is done as well.
I think what you're hearing from us is we don't want outreach teams to just be identifying that somebody exists as unhoused. We want them to be engaging them with service, getting them connected, and moving them in the direction of getting them off the streets. Okay.
And that is essentially what the multidisciplinary teams do. The struggle is they don't always have the available resources to house a resource. And so that.
We'll now move on to interim housing.
Thank you so much for all of your input. Interim housing is a temporary place for individuals experiencing homelessness to stay a while they work on a permanent housing plan. The program types included in the system KPIs are emergency shelters, motel vouchers, transitional housing, and recently InsightSafe and Pathway Home programs. Since the data we shared today is a look back on fiscal year 21-22, Project Room Key is also included for the time window, which was when it was activated. There's been a noticeable increase in the total number of individuals served by the interim housing program year over year, with roughly 2,000 individuals increased in fiscal year 21-22, and roughly 4,000 individuals increased in fiscal year 22-23. I just want to pause to see if there's any comments. Okay. In terms of throughput rate, we can see a decline echoing the declining trend over the recent three fiscal years, driven by the lower number of individuals exiting to permanent housing and a higher total number of individuals served. This indicates the need to address the factors contributing to the surge of increased individuals in permanent housing programs and enhance support systems to help them exit into permanent housing. Here we're comparing the throughput rate between fiscal year 21 through 22 and 22 to 23 in each subpopulation. As mentioned in the previous slide, the throughput percentage is down due to the increased number of enrollments, the denominator, and the second half of fiscal year 22-23. The number of individuals connected to permanent housing has remained relatively similar. Just reiterating, the increase in total serve and the numbers connected to permanent housing, the rate will decrease. To see the percentage rate increase, there needs to be an increase in permanent housing connections. We're now looking at the difference between subpopulations. Each race and ethnicity group shows a decrease in its throughput rate when comparing fiscal year 22 through 23 to the previous fiscal year, consistent with the overall trend on the previous slide. The Hispanic and Latino population is experiencing lower throughput into permanent housing than the average 14% across all populations. Further analysis is needed to address the barriers that are preventing Hispanic and Latino individuals from accessing permanent housing at a higher rate. Time-limited subsidies, formerly rapid rehousing, support people to transition to permanent housing, including relocation, stabilization services, and rental assistance. in the short-term support, often 1 to 3 years, help individuals move as quickly as possible into permanent housing as they gain employment, increase benefits, and or receive housing vouchers to keep them housed long-term. The majority of people rehoused by LASA receive this type of assistance. Decrease in the number of time-limited subsidy enrollments can be attributed to the factors to ensure people are document ready and have a unit identified prior to being connected to a time-limited subsidy program, TLS. Providers encourage to connect individuals to housing navigation prior to being enrolled in TLS. The graph also shows the number of individuals served by TLS program group by those housed and not housed. There has been a consistent upward trend in the percentage of individuals housed in time-limited subsidies over the past 2 fiscal years, peaking at 80%. In fiscal year 22-23, and coming slightly lower at 78% in Q4. The decrease in total individuals drives this to serve by 8,000 to 9,000 per quarter and below 6,500 per quarter by the end of fiscal year 2022-23, driven mostly by the non-housed individuals represented by the dark blue color. To summarize, the data suggests a rise in proportion of housed individuals and the total number of individuals served is decreasing. This scenario may warrant further research to determine the cause and develop strategies to understand the underlying factors that influence this behavior. Next slide. What does this data mean and how likely are we to house depending on our race and ethnicity numbers? Consistent with overall trends in the percentage of individuals housed in the previous graph, all race groups have shown an increase compared with the previous fiscal year. The larger race groups, our Black population shows a 10% increase to 81%. The Latino and Hispanic population shows a 14% increase to 76%. And our white population shows a 16% point increase to 74%. Smaller race and ethnicity groups are Asian, Native, Indian, and other Pacific Islanders, American Indian and Native, and Alaska Native, and multiracial, less than 5% of the population, which shows a lower overall 77% rate. And again, because of the smaller group, the numbers are, they fluctuate and exacerbated. Next slide. We're almost at the end, I promise. Now let's look at the data about people experiencing homelessness being housed. We want to ensure the housing option works so that people don't become homeless again. To this end, we monitor the percentage of individuals who became housed again within 6 months, 12 months, and 24 months after being housed. There has been an increase in the return of homelessness rates year over year across all of the different 6, 12, and 24 months. The latest status shows 12% of adults returning to homelessness after 12 months and 17% after 24 months. I would like to share the national average. So for 2021-22, it's reported the national rates 7.3% for 6 months, 11% for 12, and 16.5% for 24 months. And this is the national average. On the positive side, the rate within 6 months for fiscal year 2021 and 21-22 remains stable at 7%, indicating some effectiveness in the efforts to return to homelessness through some improvements that we've made in the system. Let me restate that. On a positive side, the rate of return within 6 months for fiscal year 2021 and 21-22 remains stable at 7%. This suggests that we need to implement strategies to make interventions sustainable for longer term solutions. We may also need to look further at our external factors such as economic conditions, availability of housing, changes in social services, and weather condition to gain a broader understanding. Next slide. And that is the end of my presentation. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. There's a lot in there, so I'm glad we took a break to get some of it digested first. Yeah. I'll now go back. Or do we have any questions or comments on the presentation? I'll start to my right.
Yeah, thank you, Megan. I got you. I really was looking at the interim housing slide and wanted to know, like, if for this presentation, I think it would be helpful to also go over the time folks can stay in these types of interim housing, as it does vary, especially when the outcomes are really low for folks transitioning out of interim housing to permanent supportive housing. So we it'll be good to get a picture of how long folks can stay in these types interim housing, each separate one.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments here?
Yeah, a couple of things. On slide 49, the individual adults housed at New Lake House and retained by kind of limited subsidies. I was just really surprised to see between quarter one and quarter four that it looks like we're serving 1,000 less individuals. And so, you know, just wanted to know, I know you said that people are trying to figure out the positive numbers just to see if it's like a significant dip. But I don't know if you guys have any ideas.
My colleague, Marina Jenkins, is here.
Good morning, Commissioners. Marina Ganshev, Director of System and Planning for anyone in the board and planning for
you speak up, please? Sorry, the people are listening at home and they can't quite hear. Thanks. Good morning, Commissioners. Marina Ganshev, Director of System and Planning with LASA. Some of the difference that you see is in result of a change that we've made intentionally to how we're using the time limited subsidy program. Instead of enrolling people prior to being housed in that program, we're using housing navigation to do the work of seeking housing. And upon the identification of a unit, we are moving people into that housing using the time limited subsidy program. So what that means is the program turns on a little bit later. So you see less people in the program overall, but what you will see over time is more permanent housing placements and people being served at a more appropriate case management ratio. So a lower number in this case is actually a good thing because it means a higher placement rate from this program and a more strategic and intentional use of the program. Does that answer your concern, Commissioner Chris?
Yeah, and then the other question that I had was the last slide on slide 51, the return to homelessness. It looks like there's an increasing number and the percentage of folks that are returning to homelessness. I think it's probably going to wait to see like that 24-month number. I know you mentioned just some of the factors that are causing that. I also think just in general, as we're looking at some of these graphs and seeing increases in trends, it would be helpful, at least for me, to see some information like listed out within this presentation to talk about what's causing the increase in some of these numbers. Because there's a lot of data here, and I think especially for folks that are watching at home, or for people that are watching or trying to look at some of the slides after the fact, to kind of have an explainer about what some of the trends are, what's causing those trends, would be really helpful.
Any other questions or comments here?
You mean in addition to what she said, in more globally, you want to have her draw it? In addition to the more global reasons why they may be affecting the trends, you want more detail, more specifically?
Yeah, and just and having that reflected here. Like, I know that that's part of the presentation, but it's having that reflected in the slide. Yeah, it would be really cool.
Commissioner Morrow, a couple of questions. First, in terms of the data that's varied, the TLS program is for a set amount of time, right? Usually 24 months, which is what the data is that you have here. So as we look at exits back to homelessness, are we already seeing some of these time periods expire for some participants? I guess what I want to get at is, are we just not seeing the aftermath of this program actually culminating. So we're still in the honeymoon phase of what we're looking at.
Yeah, it's a great question. So typically the length of time for time limited subsidy programs is 2 years, as you've stated. While we, as we are wanting to make sure that people are not returning to homelessness, we've been working with CEOHI to extend those lengths of time if people need that, while we do some other things to make sure that we have the appropriate next steps if that's what people need. A couple of those things are the shallow subsidy program, which we're continuing to look at, exploring the changes that might be needed to that program to ensure that it's serving this population well. Additionally, we just shifted to scale a process for transfers into permanent supportive housing programs from time-limited subsidy programs, which is to say that if somebody has been housed in a time-limited subsidy program and actually needs both a long-term financial assistance and a long-term case management assistance, that we are making a pathway to connect the dots so that people don't return to homelessness but can retain in housing with a voucher and the services that they need.
Thank you. And in terms of the data that's presented as well, and coming from a service provider perspective, you end up with a lot of people that are really don't have a way of increasing their income. So you have people that are either on GR or SSI, that whatever they receive is what they're going to receive. And when they're being placed into units that are 1500, 1600, how are we able to then, I guess nothing's guaranteed, but how do we mitigate for that? How do we plan and say, okay, so we already know this person's not going to be able to increase their rents, so I can increase their income. How do we ensure that they then don't go back into the streets? And within that, I'd like to see data as to what percentage of people that are currently enrolled in the program fall into that, and if that's something that we need to, you might probably already doing some planning around that.
Right. Well, I would just say across the board, we know we're reaching the cliff. I mean, in a way, it's happened is we've been backed into a corner, right? And we've addressed the long-term problem with a short-term solution, but that's all we had at hand. And so we drove up the market with the rehouse dollars. We know that. Many landlords now say, well, I'd like that resource, please, not the voucher. And the thinking was that resource would be made available for folks who could earn more eventually, not even knowing and projecting out fully how hard it would be for us to get people connected to education and career opportunities that would allow them to be more stable and to take on more of those rents. So we drove up the rents and we paid the rents, and now we're dealing with the aftermath. So that's why you're going to see conversations about master leasing and shared housing and creative ways that families will have to come together, because no matter what, they're just not able to handle the rents. And at the time when we are saying we have to get kids out of cars, you sort of have to deal with what you deal with. And you get people and you use the substance, the subsidy that we have. And now we are in the situation that's got to back it up. And this is a system-wide issue.
Thank you. And then last data, once again, I don't like calculating it, but I like reading it. In terms of the average investment per person, what are we spending? Especially when we're paying $1,500 a month, for example, for someone who is on a fixed income for rent. What does that look like and how, in terms of larger impact as we evaluate whether the strategy, what can be improved for what? Thank you.
Thank you. Supervisor Barker.
Thank you. I just am curious, what stakeholders are you engaged with regarding the RPI or the KPI goals? Is it regional? Because for me, my smaller cities, I think their frustration is being in alignment with the localized goals that are being set. And so I just am curious to know how that plays out.
Yep. So I would say that we've talked a little bit about some things that we're thinking about for goals, like the example of wanting to ensure that we're moving at least 25% of people from outreach into interim housing. So these are some kind of goals that we've been thinking about so far, but the point at which that we would be bringing set goals for the next fiscal year to commitment would be a point at which we already would have worked with providers to vet that. I think that the next step that you heard about working with the county to have a countywide KPIs for not everything, but certainly for these high level
throughput and process metrics is something that will be an important precursor, because we as LASA could set goals today, but it's important to think globally about programs serving people experiencing homelessness.
That's what I want to figure out. I think it's important to recognize that there are small cities that could benefit, and I think would benefit us as well, to standardize that so that we have a clearer understanding.
And I don't know that we have the mechanism to engage the small cities properly. I don't think we're having that. When I do the listening sessions.
When you say we, do you mean LASA?
I think the system as a whole. I think the system as a whole, we have to have more systems.
We are changing.
And that is being changed.
Yeah.
So with that change and the listening sessions, when I'm out there hearing from them, they're able to share the challenges that they're facing and how those numbers will relate. So we need to have more of those global conversations with the small cities and all the rest of the system.
Madam Mayor?
I'll go back to a question I asked earlier, which is, and by the way, thank you for all the data. I really appreciate that. But I'm very interested as to why people weren't unhoused and where is that documented? Because why people were unhoused and what was done to address their needs? Because we talk about the economics a lot, and we talk about people returning to homelessness, but if we're not addressing why they became unhoused to begin with, and specifically what is done to address what led to them being unhoused, then it's not a surprise if they return to homelessness, regardless of the economic support. So is there somewhere where that is documented, whether they're TAY, whether they're a senior, well, all of the different things. And then again, you know, the other issue that I'm always concerned about is the services and specifically what is
not of it. Yes, we can pull that information from you out of our HMIS system.
So time limits is a lot of money and resources that we and so going forward, you know, those dollars we anticipate reduction, keeping them at that level, increase, because it's a wonderful resource. I mean, I think time with the Southerners have given us that chance to make sure that we get people in as quickly as possible. And during the 2 year period of time, we're able to then get them to the next level and to move into some kind of permanent housing, whatever that may be. But from the funding standpoint, and this, you know, messed up yesterday, but funding, our time limit subsidies, I know, are government funding, but that is city, county, federal. Remind me.
Come on. In the spirit of us all being here together, we might as well have the person that can answer that. Take the money.
The time limit is sensitive. So, good morning. I'm Sheree Potteroff, the director of the Homeless Initiative in the County of Los Angeles. The steady funding for the time limited subsidy program has largely been Measure H funded. There have been other sources of funds that may have been more time limited, but this ongoing steady piece has been Measure H funded. We are currently going through our funding recommendation cycle, starting for fiscal year 24-25. There's an extensive stakeholder process to get input into that. As part of that process, it would not be surprising to see a recommendation come out that we increase the time limited subsidy program. Especially with the reworking that has been done by LASA, really focusing those dollars on people who have identified a housing unit to lease up in, which means those dollars will get higher utilization, where previously where clients were enrolled in the program, when they weren't able to lease up, those dollars remain unexpended. So this switch will increase the utilization of those dollars and increase the opportunity for investment.
Thank you.
Commissioner Chinchilla.
Just a quick question. So Emily, thanks so much for your presentation and thank you for all this data. It's wonderful to look at. I know that we've had data quality issues in the past, so I just wanted to ask if there are any data caveats that we should keep in mind as we're looking at what's being presented.
Yes, to answer your question, yes. But also I just wanted to reiterate, we're also partnering with Gartner to do some intentional work with LASA around best practices and frameworks on how to address data quality issues within our systems.
And we're also working with the California Policy Lab, and so we feel really good about the data that we're sharing today.
Thank you.
Okay, that's great to know.
I thought that's what you meant.
Yeah, we wanted to know how good the data was because I know you have a lot of missing.
No, much better.
Yeah, not
and,
perfect.
And then more of a just general comment. It's really great to see the different pieces of the work being broken out, right? The different steps. And I think that I would really love to see, and I know lots of moving in this direction, like lots of being a lead in terms of what are the best practices, what are the evidence-based practices that folks that are implementing at every stage must be doing and putting to work. So I really look forward to us as an organization moving forward in that direction. And that will include also keeping an eye out for culturally specific practices, culturally appropriate practices as well.
I have a lot of specific questions I'll follow up on, but in the interest of time, I'll just keep my comments brief and say, I think for me, what this report is important about for me is to understand what it is you're measuring, what you see as important to measure. And that might be different than what we see. So this was a really helpful level set, I think, in that regard. So thank you for the work that you did in this presentation. I think overall, I would like our KPIs to help us tell a narrative of the work that's being done to address the crisis that is homelessness beyond, especially beyond our point in time count. So much is reliant on that number and how we're talking about this story. And we can see from what you've shown us today that so much more is being done. And so we have to make sure that we are telling a comprehensive story. The data is important not only for measurements, but helping us to inform that story and where we're going. And I'm working to connect with my colleagues on the board, council members in Los Angeles, small city organizations, and our partners and stakeholders to ask them that question too. So we'll be shifting and informing how we, what we're measuring, because I know you get asked a lot about data, and we don't want to just ask you to pump out numbers for the sake of numbers. We want them to actually be telling a story that is meaningful and helping us understand what we're actually doing, especially with the dollars that are being invested into the system already. So I'll leave it there. I know we have a couple of speakers.
Good morning, Eric Freeman. You're allowed to speak.
But this has been my dream job for 23 years. I've loved every minute of my grant.
Good morning. Go ahead and speak.
Hello.
I didn't do it without.
Can you hear me?
Or from my family, my husband.
Yes. Can you hear
me? Sorry, we cannot hear you. Can you speak louder?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Son-in-law, dad.
I'm sorry. Can you hear
Rafael,
me now?
My. He's my grandson who had the opportunity
okay.
to.
I'll try to mute this other thing. I'm sorry. I apologize. Thank you. I was just going to say, I listened and watched the data closely, and I'm a little anxious that we're very, very deep in the studying and looking. I agreed with the mayor that we should try to understand what's the cause, but honestly, we don't really have the wherewithal while we're trying to house people to do all of that. And it starts to become impossible to onboard for an ordinary brain. I'm not joking. When you look at the difference between 7% and 9% and 12% across so many years and different periods, it all bleeds into nothing for an ordinary resident. So I think this is great because you need the data, but let's synthesize it quickly, get rid of all the chuffa and focus on housing. I don't want to do Kevin DeLeon's speeches. We've all heard them before. You know, but it's enough with the study. We don't need another study. I believe in information, but I just think we have to trim this way back and get back to inside safe. Good work. Thanks.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Susan Shaw. You're welcome to speak. Ms. Shaw, can you please unmute your camera or in your phone? Suzanne Shaw, you're welcome to speak.
Okay, next speaker, please.
Katie V. Kennedy, you're welcome to speak.
Thank you. I am absolutely unopposed to interim shelter. It saves lives, but the sort of the problem we're seeing right now is people being in multiple interim programs. like Project Room Key, then Insights or Out, and then Insights Safe. So we really need to focus on interim to permanent, in my opinion, and that should be the main focus. If people are just not going into permanent housing successfully, I really appreciate Mayor Bass keep asking about the source, because really all the people that I meet on the street, you know, I'm not a social worker. I consider myself no different than anybody else. So in conversations, I meet so many people that are on a fixed income, either disabled or senior, and they cannot afford rent. And by the time they get that, if they get a voucher, it's just mission impossible. So we really need to focus on capital, purchasing capital, and developing permanent housing and measuring interim to permanent, because that's the real solution. And these vouchers just, I mean, they're good for some people, but so not good for many. And thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Suzette Shaw, you're welcome to speak. Suzette Shaw, can you please unmute yourself?
Okay, any other speakers? We're having an issue connecting her.
Pamela Crenshaw, you're welcome to speak.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for taking such an interest in our community and really beginning to do a lot of good things. Sorry, I was in the doctor. I couldn't comment at the time when the topics were up, but I want to ask about, ask Mayor and City Council to secure funding for the upkeep of the permanent supportive housing in which you're putting people in from the streets. We need money for maintenance and services, and the owners of the permanent supportive housing are saying that they have no funding for that. But it says permanent supportive housing, so it's supposed to be supportive. We have a lack of qualified case managers, property managers. Many tenants are living in unhabitable conditions, which are not conducive to their recovery from being on the streets and their health and their safety. And then also the aging factor and the disabilities. So also like funding for seniors, disabled, and sober tenants to move on to escape these environments in which they were left in order to improve their quality of life. And I'm one of them. And we need more funding to make these units habitable. We're really suffering with the older units. So I am pleading with you to please consider funding the older permanent supportive housing, and also consider building more buildings for our seniors who have moved on. You know, I never did this thing called old before. It's not always fun, but, you know, I have to consider my health and safety. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
Pamela Crenshaw, you're welcome to speak.
I'm sorry.
Albert Pelosio, you're welcome to speak.
Good morning. First of all, I just want to thank you all for doing what you're doing. I know personally as a community health worker in the past that it's generally a thankless job, but you also know that the times you are able to help people, that's all the thanks you need. I really commend, you know, the changes, the constantly refocus of as you learn, you're refocusing everything. And that's such a hard job. I'm going to say impossible. But thank you for continuing and not giving up. I know it can be such a difficult position to not get anywhere, but when you do, it's worth it. What I would like to see is I would like to see more outreach to the community at large, asking them to do their part. I don't think we do enough of that. I don't think we give people enough opportunities at large to let people help in any way they can. And then I really want to support the potential of a commission comprised of people with lived experience that would have a very helpful voice in your community and this community at large. So that's my two asks. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
We have no further speakers.
Thank you very much. This item was a report to receive and file. We will take that action as noted and move on to item six, which is our report on coordinated entry system redesign. Welcome.
Good morning, commissioners, and thank you.
Thank you.
I have not had the chance to address you yet as the Chief Program Officer of LASA, so I would like to introduce myself, Dr. Adeline Miller. I go by Abby, she, they pronouns. And I am really happy to be here. This marks the end of my fourth week. I want to say all eyes are on Los Angeles right now. That is a positive thing. I am coming from a federal career and like to think about not stepping into this role as one person, but actually as a tapestry of people and national partners. And I think this is it's a very positive moment for all of us in the midst of the humanitarian crisis that we're dealing with, that we are coming together in this way. I also want to say a few things about some of the questions that you had in the last presentation as a chief program officer. I hear what you're craving, and I am committed to knitting together the funding implications, the different components. If we change housing navigation to TLF, like to cover part of TLS, what does that mean? Why did we make that change? Spoiler alert, it's to reduce our underspend. But we're doing all of this in a system, and each of these components is in relation to another component, just as each of us and our work is in relation to many other people. So we will be continuing to knit this together, and you have my commitment to excellence in practice and in what we present to you each month. I want to paint the, if you can go to the next slide, I want to paint the historical backdrop just a bit to talk about coordinated entry. So we are only 36 years in to having any federal authorization or funding to work on homelessness, 36 years. And we are 14 years from when that was reauthorized as the Hearth Act. That is significant because the Hearth Act is the first time that as a nation, we said, we care about performance, the system matters, and that this is about ending homelessness, not about managing. So at that 09, when the Hearth Act was introduced, HUD then took steps and 3 years later put a COC program, continuum of care program, interim rule in place. What that interim rule did is require coordinated entry for everybody in the country, every single continuum of care. And that was for a reason. I hear the conversations happening today about coordinated entry, the frustrations, very valid. However, before coordinated entry existed, we had a different set of frustrations. We had providers who each kept their own wait list. And if you were experiencing homelessness, you had to figure out who those providers were, go around to each one of them, get on their wait list, ingratiate yourself because there were no standards about who would actually get in the door. And providers were permitted to make business-based decisions like who is going to fit my program the best, not how do I make my program fit the needs the best. So that was the situation. That was the reason for coordinated entry being introduced and mandated. It was mandated in 2012. In 2017, HUD passed a full set of requirements. 5 years is a long time in a large sector like ours. And in those 5 years, decisions were made by a lot of people. We had the VI-SPDAT introduced across the country. We had by name lists as a best practice, but it wasn't really a best practice because we hadn't done it before.
So I think everything that we talk about a lot, we need to remember these are very recent introductions to the field, and they are they were the best thinking at the time. There was no ill intention. The idea is we need to organize this. We need to make sure that it's equitable. We need to make sure that resources are distributed well. And everybody took a stab at that. We made a lot of mistakes. There was racial bias before coordinated entry existed. There is still racial bias. And what we have figured out over time is that the BI-SPDAP actually doubled down on the racial bias that existed in the system. We didn't know that at the time. Nobody set out to reify that into the structure. But what it did by having a tool that everybody was using was guarantee that racial bias would continue. We don't want to do that. And we also cannot throw out the entire system because there are many benefits that we've gotten. And it continues to be a requirement by the federal government. But there is a reason why this system was put in place. And I think it's incumbent on LASA as a system lead and on our partners, providers, you all, to figure out together how we embrace what is working, how we get rid of what is not working, and move strategically as quickly as we can, but not make sloppy, unforced errors in that process. So I want to say a little bit about what coordinated entry is doing well. It has coordinated a disparate array of services, providers, projects, funding sources, and brought them into relationship with each other. I won't say alignment always, but it has brought them into relationship with each other. It has led to a more equitable distribution of resources, as Dr. Adams-Kellum said in her opening remarks. And we have achieved quite a bit of coordination with the service planning area for the SPA systems. What is not working is taking too long to lease up our PSH, permanent supportive housing buildings. People are struggling to get housed in their own community. We've created a very long community queue that was based on individual by individual, which is wildly inefficient and also not equitable. We have an acuity measure that reifies racial bias in the system. And we have this growing understanding that we have to actively manage this system because there are so many partners involved, so many perspectives, so many demands and needs and bottom lines that we have to be able to make decisions together and we have to move quickly. So LASA understands we have a role in actively managing the system. We have a lot of vacancies as a result, which is not okay. So if you go to the next slide. These are the reimaginings that we are going through. I'll just talk briefly about each of these. I just spoke to active system management. What does that mean? It means that LASA is leading the process to get people from housing or from the streets, from interim housing to permanent housing more quickly, more efficiently. Along those same lines, we have new permanent supportive housing prioritization. We are no longer doing a community queue where it's individual by individual. Instead, if you are vulnerable, we don't need to pit you in competition against somebody else who is vulnerable. Let's just say we have a very vulnerable cohort of people who can all be prioritized, and HUD has allowed for that. We are doing batch matching, meaning when we have a building, let's say it has 10 units, we don't just reach out to 10 people, we reach out to 20 people so that we can get there faster. We're using a universal housing application so that we don't have multiple applications across multiple entities that make it harder and more cumbersome to get people into housing. We are pursuing universal forms, verification of homelessness, verification of disability, This all has to be streamlined, because in a system like this, every form represents time and effort. We are pursuing new coordinated entry assessment tools, thanks to the work of the California Policy Lab and many other people. They have evaluated the BIs for that. They have developed findings and not only a new tool, but a process for ongoing evaluation going forward so that we do not reify bias in the system. And with that, I will turn it to Dr. Adams.
Stay nearby.
I'm here. Next slide. The next slide really spells out what you just said, I believe. And you can even tell me whether you think we missed any pieces. I don't know that it's helpful to go step by step. I mean, one of the things I used to complain about this slide is that I felt like it was a slide that says, it's not us, we're just one of these boxes. And I think really what we want to say is it's a complicated process and it's a handoff process. And maybe that's why it's been slow, because it's the next step and the next step, and each step it's 2 months, it's 3 months, et cetera, versus now with active system management, you're working on several steps at one time. And that Lhasa is really owning this.
So can you just say what's different instead of going from box to box? Because I've seen this trick.
Exactly. Let's go to the next slide. So I think it's this next slide that you're asking, you know, what is different? What is the old CS, Permanent Support and Palliative Guidance, and what is the new guidance? And so if we look at this, we're talking about in the old, matching folks to this queue. And I think for those of us that have been frustrated, even providers, I was a late adopter, part of it was I've got this person in front of me. Like you're saying, I can't house this person in front of me. I gotta go in the queue. And I think that might be part of the disconnect at times with the outreach teams, because you got this person in front of you, but we have this queue. And being a provider that had a lot of housing resources on the west side, it was really unfair that Veronica Hoppix in spot six had a lot of people and no resources. So again, this match situation was important. But again, now the new is saying not just this queue, what about the person in front of me? What about the outreach team? What about the elected official that went and told everybody at the community meeting that that building was gonna help? And it didn't, because everyone in the building is from outside the community. And there's a balance that we have to find there. You can't be all or nothing. I mean, we have to find it, because not everyone's building buildings. And sometimes we're doing inside saving and pathway home in areas where there's not buildings. So what are those folks going to just stay with forever? So I think that working together is important. But the idea that you go to a community meeting and say, at least we'll reduce by 10% or 20%, and folks just see their situation worse and the buildings are coming up, that's just not appropriate. The CES score was used in this descending order, and it had equity issues, as Abby mentioned. And now we're still using the CES. I mean, we have to be honest about that, because we have to use some kind of system of measurement, but we're cutting into it at an 8 score, which we believe is less biased. Now, this new instrument, I'm not going to just go and embrace it, because if we do, we'll miss this opportunity to continue to assess and evaluate. But we are still using the 8+, because that's what locks us in to the services that are required and the support we need from DHS, ICMS workers, DMH, and so forth. So we do have to use some kind of tool. Document readiness. So oftentimes we have the person, and then we have to rush to get their documents and birth certificates and so forth. And now we're saying there are folks we've been working with, and they are already document ready. Let's focus on those folks and those people and move forward. And I think that just makes plain sense. And we can admit to you that we didn't do that before and we're doing it now. And yeah, just something you might be wondering, why did we ever think of this? Well, part of it would be my wonder, is there a barrier? And we are finding a barrier to people who don't have documents. That's another thing. But I wondered, would it be a barrier to people? Would it be another way to add more bias? And so my first question before I approved this one came in was, how is this showing up for people of color who may not have the documents or access? And the report back was similar numbers of Black and Brown people have their documents. So we'll have to keep watching that to see if that's actually true. When new permanent supportive housing buildings open, people were matched one unit at a time. And now we're doing what we call batch matching. Now there is, so I'll say, that's what the differences are that we're proposing. Next slide.
Can I ask a quick question on that previous slide? For document ready, do all of our PSH resources require social security numbers?
Right.
Because from my understanding, there's Housing for Health that does not require that.
So I cannot speak to that, but I know we have Kiara Payne and Maria Ganchev back here, both are making answers.
You're asking for me to be my case manager, so I'm back and I don't know.
Yeah.
Good morning, Commissioners. Kiara Payne, Associate Director of Permanent Housing. To answer your question, yes, all PSHs for funded by federal subsidies still require this, the Social Security and date of birth to be presented, not at the time that we enter, waivers, but we do have to provide them to be able to retain the subsidy for the client afterwards.
Shereen, you want to check in? Just to build on that, there is some PSH that does not use federal subsidies. It's locally funded. We've used Measure H dollars and other county dollars to fund the rent and permanent supportive housing. And in those cases, it does not necessarily require a social security number. I would add that this has been done largely through the Housing for Health and Flexible Housing Subsidy Pool through various investments over the years. This has been one of the most effective ways to be able to lease up as quick as possible and to be able to generate new housing development is that commitment of rental subsidy resources through the Flexible Housing Subsidy Pool. Thank you.
Sweet. Go ahead.
Did you want to follow up?
Yeah, I was just going to say, well, thank you for clarifying that, because I think the language can be a little bit confusing and misleading. And I remember, and I think this was before your time, Dr. Adams-Kellum, there was a notice that went out to providers that said that there was prioritization happening for those that were document ready and that it included social security numbers. And some providers did reach out to me that serve folks that are maybe undocumented or non-citizen populations, and they expressed a lot of alarm around the phrasing that was being used and that the information was being disseminated. So I'd like to request that these slides have a correction on that, or may at least make a note to have a note to also specify that this does not apply to all PSH units.
Well, I think the wording is that the federally funded does, and which ones, just to be really clear, because
yes,
I don't want folks to go, well, then which ones?
Yeah.
That's going to be confusing. So we can make it more clear.
The clarity.
Absolutely.
Madam Mayor.
So I think given the, and again, with Housing for Health, I don't know how many resources we have to cover folks that are undocumented, but given the dramatic increase in Latino homelessness, it seems like whatever amount we had is probably not enough. And that one thing that I would suggest that we do is that we figure out a dollar amount and go to the state now while the governor is putting his budget together, and to see if we can, in the same way the state has responded to healthcare for undocumented, we need more.
Thank you.
So next slide. I think this is, again, more detail than is needed. I think we basically described batch matching. So next slide. And I think then this is just the high level process yet again that suggests that our goals are to make sure that prior to the temporary certificate of occupancy is garnered, that we're beginning to work on getting people ready. So you're not saying, okay, TCO, go. It's saying, we know when thereabouts we're going to have a certificate of occupancy. We start 45 days ahead and begin this process of getting lists, pulling lists together, and making sure that we're then referring those to the groups that are going to start doing the matching. And for lots of them to begin to make sure we're actively managing that process to move things forward. Are there more things you think I should highlight in here?
I think the important thing with slides like this is that this is information for you all to see the processes laid out. And for me, when I start to tackle something that isn't working, I want to see this so that I can say, where are we getting bogged down? So this is, I think, this is information that we come back to, but I don't think there's anything else for today. Yeah.
Okay. Next slide. So I think it's important for you to know that LASA is using this active system management with the entire project-based permanent supportive housing lease process. So we're centralizing this process. And there are a lot of inputs and a lot of voices that we're managing. Our leadership role is in providing detailed unit level and client level project management of this process. That's what we call active system management. We're problem solving. So when we're calling week by week, we're saying, what's the holdup? What are the issues? Reminding folks of waivers, et cetera. Holding all partners accountable, including ourselves. Elevate system level issues. We're having lots of meetings. And honestly, those meetings are not always fluid and we're not always coming to agreement on ways to move forward, which sometimes can pose a barrier. And I think that in the future, having all of us together at times, I think we'll come and say, these are the two or three things that we're grappling with and we need to have folks start weighing in. That's just it. We're trying to get to agreement. And that's a challenge at times.
Can I ask you a question? I know Housing Central Command was created before, yes. Again, and that's part of this and managing all the other departments. But I think to build upon that with the leadership perhaps to the left and right who control some of those other departments that are in those areas, where is it that we need to support them or push them depending upon that action? And so that would be really important as to making sure that any of those challenges or barriers that you have in implementing some of these lease up process that they are willing participants and partners in making sure that we have the resources necessary.
I'm really proud to say that all the partners, they're all in improving the system. And I think we're all ready to admit that CES was not a perfect system, but that there are good things that we want to keep and things that we want to change. Where we start to struggle is the priorities. Is it pace? Is it who? Is it local? Is it making sure HUD is feeling like we're aligned? There's a lot of competing demands, and at times, there are three or four things that could all be number one. And I think that's when we collectively weigh in and say, is pace more important or local? Is local and pace versus, you know, who purchased or who is funding the supportive housing? And that's what we've been looking at, a building by building approach for now. But I worry at times that will slow us down because it isn't clear what is our overall process. So I'm just saying, the honest me coming to you will be that there are times we're going to need leadership to tell us it's pace over priority. It's, you know, and even the sense that we've got to learn, and here's another thing we're grappling with. You've got people in interim housing, and one of the callers said, hey, interim to permanent. But we're pulling people off the street immediately now. And we can't have them just on the sidelines in these expensive hotel stays, or even what the county's doing is master leasing hotels, which I know the city's going to do as well. We got to merge them in. And how do we go about that?
Can I ask you just really quickly, on the CDS, how flexible can we be with the HUD mandate? I mean, I guess my question is, you've got people at this table who have the ability to reach out. Are we able to be nimble and pivot on the CES if we amend it?
We can be. I think there are things that can slow us down. But in general, I wrote a lot of the requirements for coordinated entry. You know, I gotta come clean. But I would say from the beginning of coordinated entry, it has been it's felt like a fight to keep the spirit of it in there without it becoming just about well, are we compliant? And what I have said for years is you can have a fully compliant coordinated entry system that is incredibly ineffective. So I think there is a lot of room actually within the requirements to be more nimble than we have been. And there is also always room to go back to the people who wrote it or who are currently maintaining it as a set of requirements to say, hey, this really is not working for us. Explain it, request a waiver.
So I think the rest of the slides we've already really covered and we can move on and go to questions.
Okay, so was there anything else in the comparison between where we've been and where we are slash where we're going that you wanted to make sure we cover before we jump into questions and comments?
I will highlight one thing.
Okay.
So our housing authority partners have requested waivers and we have received some of those. The ones that are statutorily allowable to be waived. And I wanna highlight Kiara Payne's work on this. She has been bending over backwards to really work with the partners and get these done. And this is a very exciting thing. So I just wanna make sure we put that out there on the record.
I think the other thing, maybe we go to slide 9 of the PowerPoint. Can you go back? Okay. The reason I wanna raise this is because we said we wanted to start grappling with what's working. And I think we want to make sure, keep going. I think we want to make sure when we highlight here, we now have a couple of systems going. And that's because we're just still grappling with what is our coordinated system going to be. One is putting the developers back in the driver's seat a little bit more. And the other is what we described as this new prioritization process that you just heard Abby and I discuss. And what we're giving you is some sense of the TCO date, the how many and percent of applications or matching that's been approved, the public housing authorities and how they're doing. And as you can see, in a lot of ways, there's a lot of great work happening. And then where we're targeted to reach our goals. And so right now we see Wilcox looks to be on track, is my understanding. And then Palm Vista is an example of a developer led. And I think probably what the developers are saying is, we want to test this out and see what it's like for us to go back to maybe with a little less stringency. And what our timeline may be suggesting is there more that we need to be doing together? Is there that coordination that's missing in the timeline? Is there anything in the active system management piece that we can do, but I can hear my team saying, well, if we're active system management, if we're doing that, it's really more the new CS prioritization. So this other kind of way of doing this work has less of that. It has kind of less LAFA, less CES, and less and things of that nature. And we're just trying to grapple with it. And so this isn't telling you at the end of the day, one system that works better than another. We're just trying to figure out what are the variables and what do we know works. We know coordination works. We know active system management works. And we know that if we can get the right mix, developers working with LASA, working with funders works, but it's in what proportion and we don't want to slow it up. So that's what I wanted to share.
Okay, questions or comments on where we're going? Commissioner Price?
Hi, I just had a quick question just in regards to the document readiness piece. So if we do have somebody that, you know, does not have some sort of valid identification or social security number, but not just because they're undocumented, but simply because they've lost it, how are we assisting them with, you know, getting prepared, getting your documents together? I know this is a big issue that, you know, folks living on the streets face, and I've certainly seen it within my own family, and, you know, losing IDs, losing social security cards, I mean, especially if they don't have face work. So what's that process look like, especially if, you know, we're prioritizing the prepared documents by date? So
that's a big part of what the outreach teams do, the navigators do. That is
as a central role of our providers and anyone working with folks who are moving out of encampments, even in encampments, work on getting the documents together. So it doesn't mean document only. It means who's ready, that's who we match. And then as other people are getting their documents, we move. It just means we're not waiting for documents to show up. That's what we, but we're always working to get documents, always. Yes.
Madam Mayor, I know this is a hot topic for you again.
It is a hot topic for me, but let me just one, so glad you're here. Really appreciate your history, and I understand your history, and especially, you know, you were involved in developing CES, and I never questioned the intentions of policy, but, you know, policies are made at a particular period of time, and oftentimes there's nothing put in to evaluate policy when conditions change, and so to me, over time, as conditions change, you need to look back at that policy and you are willing to look at that and evaluate it and make some changes. And so I look forward to figuring that out, you know, along the way. I had, back to what Commissioner Perez was saying about document readiness, the waiver that we got that is not 100% presumptive eligibility, but it does make some steps. Doesn't that take care of what you were saying? Meaning that somebody might not have their ID or their social security number, but I thought that they were able to come in.
Absolutely.
Anyway, while they got it, on page 9, I'm looking at Palm Vista versus Wilcox, and I was wondering why the lease up is so low. I know that that's the alternative seat with 25% CES at all, and that's really low. And then HUD seemed to be one, I mean, when we approached them about CES, you know, they require CES, but their response was they didn't require necessarily how we were going about it. We said that. We decided how to implement CES, and not everybody does it the same way that we do. So, one, are additional waivers needed from HUD? If that's the case, are additional federal waivers? I'd like to know. So, anyway, those were comments and questions mixed together.
We're still figuring out what's happening with Palm Vista versus Wilcox. We think part of it is developers do benefit from working with us in coordination, but it depends on who you ask, the why. That's why I'm not making a judgment. There may be more that LASA can do, but then that still means it's a new CES part. It's different than the going along that I think we're grappling with it, and more to come.
The only thing I would add to the question about whether we need to request waivers,
more
waivers specific to coordinated entry, or just across the board, I would say I'm not able to answer that today. What I can say with strength is that is one of the things on my priority list, is to figure out where we need flexibilities and what can we do versus what do we need to ask the federal government to help us do.
I just had one other question. Do we keep track of the number of individuals that are like document ready and, you know, that basically are ready to go and get into housing? And I'd be really interested to see like that number compared to the amount of units that we have available, right? Those folks are essentially like ready to go. So
I'm hearing from PR. Yes, in fact, we do. Do you have anything to add to the rest of this?
I mean, that's the reason why we can do this, is that we know who's document ready. And that's why there's always been this concern that we've been waiting and we actually have people in the queue. And so that's why we're going with that batch.
Yeah. I'd love for us to see those numbers.
What percentage of the total folks in the space are document ready?
We can know that in the future. We can help you know that in the future.
Go ahead. She said there's a lot of people with documents. We'll have more details for you.
That's encouraging. Thank you so much for this presentation and for the needed updates that are going to help support our overall goals. I'm really grateful for that. The only piece that I'm not hearing just yet is
what we always have. I'm based here in Culver City, and we hear a lot of disconnect from folks who are on the ground in terms of our home community project was supposed to be ready last year around this time. It's not ready now, which we're excited about, but that sort of disconnect towards I'm ready to go, I'm on the buying list, I'm going to get home key, but it's not always fully, they're not understanding all of the full pieces. And I know there's a lot of moving parts, right? But the more that we have, something to, this is what we're doing, this is, just something to sort of close that gap, because I know that folks are working hard, we're updating things, and there's just a lot of frustration that we often hear in these meetings that we hear on the ground, and so how we're communicating these updates, so people know that we are responding, and I know that we know that we're responding, and we did your 100 leads, and there is communication and information around that, but just I would just support and emphasize that we just need folks for folks who are just hey, I'm ready to go. What's up, y'all? Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes.
From a county side, Mayor has to note for Sheree, just so we're all saying that we want to make sure that funding request is done together when we're going to the state on that funding piece. So I want to make sure that we're all coordinating on that number. As we're looking at this system, and we're all quite familiar with the 12-step. It looks like LASA only owns one box of the 12. Does that mean LASA really doesn't influence or have any sort of relationship to the other 12 steps? Or how are we?
That's why I struggle with this.
We all do, but I'm
not the clarification. What is? Kiara, this will make your life a lot easier if you just own one box, huh?
No.
I think you should share, I think what Supervisor is asking me there.
So thank you for that question. I think our intent of showing this is to understand that we collectively as system partners own each individual role, and we individually have to own that role and do it efficiently and effectively. So the purpose of active system management, while LASA only owns, as you see here, the connection of the resource and clients that match that resource, is for LASA to say in our weekly lease of calls, hey, we matched somebody, but the property manager has not completed that application. Property manager, how can we support you to get that application completed? That may be us saying to the interim housing provider, let's bring that client to a lease up event, complete that application. But I'm also going to ask HACLA to be on site to complete and review that application. So we're doing everything as quickly as possible. It's more of a coordination because LASA also wants our units filled. We want to fill as soon as possible with the right people. But everybody has to do the part that they're owned and they're responsible for in a timely and effective manner.
I think a lot of the other 11 steps and who's responsible for them are often invisible to the public.
Mm-hmm.
And so then LASA becomes the name that comes out of people's mouths with anger. Why can't LASA do X? But it's not LASA where it's getting stuck necessarily. So I'm stating that for a reason. And also to say, if you don't have a relationship to getting property managers to move faster, to the things that you're mentioning, who does, and how are you surfacing that to them? So as the administrator, the system administrator, you are using that intersection, the place where you sit, to influence those people. Because I can assure you, if we knew what you know, we can use the power that we have. So how are you making that visible? How are you escalating that so we can see it?
It's in a number of ways. And again, it's about the relationships. So I have relationships with some of your staffers, the mayor's office, the supervisors, DHS, DMH. It's also a collaboration of those weekly lease-up calls for individual projects to HCC. HCC has all of those key players. I'm sorry. All those key players and their leadership from both LACDA and HACLA, as well as DMH and DHS, will be lift those up to say, hey, on this call at Palm Vista, this continues to be a situation. How can you help move that decision that we're going to make here today down so that we can start to move the needle a little bit further. It also takes some time that, you know, I call the mayor's office and say, hey, we're having this issue. We tried it this way. Can we get your support on this? And it works. Same with your office specifically, where we're saying we're having this issue as well. So it's still a collective weekly, seeing what's going on, seeing what we can resolve within the LISA call and what requires more leadership concern, our discussion at HCC leadership, and then an implementation at share out.
Well, one thing we didn't show the slide that, because we didn't want to say, well, it's working, but there's a number of buildings that you all have opened and celebrated that is actually coming out of the new prioritization process that's coming in under 45 days. And again, we didn't want to just say, oh, look, you know, because we're saying the questions are still out about what's needed, but we are seeing success. And that's why we can tell you coordination and active system management and mutual accountability is working, and it's getting into the 45 days. And Kiara has been doing an amazing job along with her team.
And I know that there are teams that would like to rely on this new modified system or feel comfortable proceeding with it. So that's part of why I wanted to have this conversation here, so we can say, yes, we're excited about the direction we're heading. We know it's not perfect, but please proceed accordingly. And we are actively keeping track of where things are getting stuck. So I think in the spirit of KPIs, tracking that data so we know, like, every time we get to step 9, we're getting stuck, you know, so we really know what where the biggest bumps in the road are and where that pressure needs to be applied or where we need to be redesigning to account for that.
I appreciate that, because sometimes we're, well, in this process as we're reimagining, it's almost like we're on hold before we get the perfect reimagined bow. And I think what you're saying is, go ahead, go forward. Let's try to get this moving and agree, and then we'll continue to iterate and take lessons learned and fix. So this is what we're trying to
do. Yeah, I don't want perfect to be the enemy of the good, especially while we're trying to get people housed off the streets. Like, we just have to, we have to do better. And I know that's what we're all committed to, but we'll keep learning what is better if we keep doing it. If we just allow ourselves to get stuck because we know it's imperfect, then it's not. We're not in the spirit of what we're trying to do in the state of emergency.
And we'll keep refining.
And we promise to keep refining it.
One specific question I wanted to ask is, how is it decided which process is used for which buildings? Because I know we have a different example. So how are you deciding that right now?
Welcome to our world of chaos.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's what we're really grappling with. We were talking for an hour last night, right?
Yeah.
Which is, what do we do when there's no inside safer pathway home near a building, but we know we need to merge some of those folks in? What do we do when, I think you asked me, do you want PACE or do you want local? What do you want?
Right.
And I think that's why I'm saying we need to hear what you want. Do you want to, you probably have more eloquent way to answer that question.
Your question, you want to know, how is the decision made to use 100% of CES with the new redesign versus the developer led?
No, I think you're saying something else. Could you repeat your question?
So you gave us a couple of examples of different specific projects that were using different systems. So more generally, how are you deciding when it's a Palm Vista process versus a Wilcox process versus,
right,
you know, all the different processes that are being used?
Right.
I'm hearing that it's not, it's organized chaos, maybe not complete chaos.
That's right.
But it's not standardized. So how are you making those decisions? What is informing your decision to apply one approach versus another?
So I want to make sure. So yes, it also depends on the eligibility and the funding of that building. Some of the funding that goes into these buildings all require 100% of CES. So those funding sources, such as No Place Like Home, requires 100% of CES to be used for those units. In those cases, if that building is majority of that, we inform the developer of those pieces, and the developer ultimately makes the decision on the strategy that they want to use for the building.
So the developers are deciding.
Yes. So informed decisions from not only LASA, but DMH and DHS in regards to the funding that is added into it.
And I think that's a concern.
for any number of reasons we can all imagine. And so I think that's one piece of system redesign we're going to have to look at for sure.
I want to understand a little more about the developer, because I know as we were suggesting changes to CES, I didn't hear, well, the developers can't go along with it. Could you explain either what categories of funding does not allow, or rather forces you to use the 100% CES?
Yes, currently that would be continuum of care. So continuum of care funds do require CES. No Place Like Home, which is capital funds from the Department of Mental Health, requires CES. The HCD funding that goes into Project Home Keys.
State housing,
requires CES as it was written into their RFP. Those are the top three that we see across our pipeline right now, where we are actively looking to see if that is a requirement when we're informing our developers during the initial discussions.
So with everything that you were saying, before, how does at the end of the day, the developer make the decision? Yeah. That seems to throw out what you said.
So yes, I think what we are running into here is who has jurisdiction where.
Right.
And I think one of the issues with, you know, coordinated entry applies to all federal, federally funded, but not necessarily state or local. And I think I'm really familiar with New York City's coordinated entry as well, and they've had these same issues. Like when there aren't that many places in the country where the continuum of care funds are much smaller than the rest of it. And in those situations, as a community, you have to make a decision. Do we invest in this thing and make the hard decisions together? Or do we say, well, we'll put coordinated entry over here and then we'll do other things over here? When you put it all together, you're able to make the hard decisions and make sure it applies everywhere. That would be my...
And we don't do that? Is that what you're saying?
No.
Well, I think when we realize that with the 25%, 75% mix,
right.
I think you heard me say immediately, we just have to do a reimagined CES.
Right.
Because we knew that we would have barriers in so many buildings. Because what had preceded, right? Because we just basically tagged everything with CES and that became mandate. So that's what we're trying to get to the sweet spot of. What was it that inspired this concern? And it was valid, because we've all had it. And those pilots that LOS has been running for the last 2 years essentially took away some of those barriers and really had some great results. Some of that happened in Marquise Harris Austin's that area, and you saw that proliferation of that work. And his team was right at the table with us the whole time. So we basically said, take the pilots. I think that's going to get to the concerns you were raising, the concerns we've had, and that's this new CES that puts the developer in. It also does batch matching, and it still also ensures that developers have an informed sense of selection based on the CES general guidelines, the things that bring us all to bear, what we want to see in this building.
And just to add to that, but if we're defining, I will say, old CES versus new CES, so that, you know, even though the state put in there, you have to follow CES, we're redefining what CES means for us locally within the HUD guidelines.
Absolutely.
That's a really important point, that it is restricted to CES, but it's how we're defining CES is going to be the change that hopefully will address
it. And we're redefining it with city and county and folks coming together to say, and developers, what do you need to see? What do you need more of? What do you need less of? And I think this.
And put ourselves in the dark.
Can I just say, I mean, I was just saying the irony is the developers get incentives, financial incentives. So I don't know who's driving the car. But I would argue that, you know, we talked at Metro, thanks to Mayor Bass, Chair Bass, and the co-op is an emotional game Metro, but we all need to be on a coordinated and on the same page. And the more you fragment how we do it, the more confusing it gets, and actually the easier it is for those to, for lack of a better term, take advantage of that fault. So I just, the Army's not lost me, though. I mean, it's not like they are doing this favor by building it, but in return, they're getting tax credits, they're getting financial windfalls, benefits, whatever you want to call it. So I think we do need to all be on the same page.
We really do, and I appreciate Abby saying, well, why did we do CS in the first place? A lot of Black and brown people are being left out of the system. They're being left out of housing. A lot of the folks with the greatest acuity that we are seeing today were not housed when just one group decided. That's why we went. We just went too far sometimes on the queue. So that's why we have to find a middle ground that addresses the issues.
And the developer-led system that we're experiencing, how did that come from the county's policies or the county requesting that? Did that come from the city? Did it come from where is that coming from? Because is that the same city or county? Is it same in all the projects?
Yeah, I mean, I just when Mayor Bass showed up on the scene and said, hey, it's a crisis. And the one thing that she heard about from all of us and everybody was CES is posing a barrier. And I believe part of it was grappling with how we tackle it. And we weren't in this space to say a little bit of this, a little bit of this. And I think part of it was, hey, how do we manage this? Developers were complaining in part to saying it's too slow. I have empty buildings. And I think the jump to it was, if it's CES that's slowing you up, how about we give you the opportunity to go it alone without it? But a lot of our developers said, we've kind of gotten used to Kiara actively managing us, and we think maybe we don't need to go it alone. Maybe we actually prefer to get help, but we just want you to clean up the lag and the bureaucracy that's making us lose so much money. So it was that conversation, but I think we've since come to some understanding that it's a middle ground that we need to reach.
So Cherie, can I ask specifically, how does the county deal with this when we have projects? Because you got two of us here. I can imagine we don't want developers driving this bus. So is that what's happening in the county?
The county is using the CES process to lease up the project-based buildings.
Which one?
Yeah, well, I was going to say,
The new one. Working with LASA on the evolution of CES and ever increasing efficiency of matching, and we're using that process.
And so that's the system that is being, you're saying, is developer led?
No, not developer led.
Okay.
No.
So the new system of CES does not have that issue.
When we describe the new reimagined CES, it is not developer led. There is a option that we now provide, especially within the city HHH, where there's not a mandate at this point. Most of those developers are picking the reimagined CES as well. And for the few that have said, we'll go it alone because we have had challenges, that's what we're tracking. So in the city, there's an option, the reimagined CES or the one that developers have a little more of the say on who gets in. And it's a pretty small percent, Kiara, right, of developers going it alone. It's really small percent.
Well, when you say the reimagine, which reimagine are we talking about?
When we say reimagine, we're talking about the one that Abby and I have been talking about.
Okay,
it's batch matching, it's document readiness, it's active system management.
We're talking about what the city council did.
It's correct. 20 in where there's 10 slots.
When
okay,
we're talking about the motion is the developer-led model that we've been talking about. The motion basically said...
The city council motion.
That's
yeah.
right. The city council motion proposed an out, right? Because so many developers were struggling. It was real. And gave an option to avoid the standard CES. But most of them didn't know that there was already a pilot to do a better job
right.
with them.
Got it.
So they've said, yeah, we'd like to stay with you all, especially now that you're doing a better job.
So is that something we can bring back to the Los Angeles City Council then, so they know that there is a new system? So,
or that, that motion wasn't good. You know what I mean?
The motion was good in the time and moment that it was proposed, and it has helped inspire something very different.
And they need to know.
And we all need to assert that and then go forward with what we think is the reimagined. And I think Kiara would just love your stamp to say, let's go, as long as you promise to keep reevaluating it. And then we would all move away from going maybe backwards to a developer-led system that I know could have some pieces.
Well, one, I do not want to take up time in this meeting for all my 100 questions.
I know.
So maybe we can have a side meeting.
Yes.
I'm more than happy to do what you just said.
Wonderful.
Yes. And I think you're going to get, like there was like a silent fiesta that just happened. Because there's this whole conversation, you know, really, we want it to be different. And my accomplice in dismantling what is not serving us in this system, you know, I wanted to make sure that you were part of this conversation. We had it on our agenda in July, and I wanted to make sure that you were here, because there are a lot of people who need us to step up and say what is working, what is not, and surface where we're getting stuck and what is problematic. And so this was incredibly helpful in that regard. I think it's also leaving some more questions that we have to answer. But I think what you're hearing for a going forward basis, the new CES, the modified CES that we are working with today, that we are still improving, do you have direction from us as a commission? Do you have what you need to empower people to use that to try and improve, continually improve, so we're not getting stuck with the old system? Do you have what you need, or do you need further clarification? Because you got us now.
Yes, I have what I need.
Great. I'm glad. And this, okay. Anything else?
And then Abby fix the whole thing.
Magic wand, Abby. Okay, do we have speakers on this item? Okay, no speakers. This was also a report, so we will receive and file it. Moving on to item 7, in the interest of time. I know that there's a desire to understand safe parking overall. I didn't want to continue this yet again because I know that people are paying attention. But can we not get instead of a full report on everything that's being done on safe parking, can you help us understand? I know this specific item came in response to the fact that we discontinued an RFP process. The county was going to fund it, and instead the county is using funding differently to address safe parking. So maybe we can just start with that specific question and then prepare a broader discussion of safe parking, of all the different things that are being done for safe parking, just so we can be on record about what happened with that RFP process.
I think that's a great idea. Okay. And if you could put on the agenda in the future, because we also want to talk about efficacy, et cetera. So it seems like that was all much better if we put it at a different time.
Okay, but to address that specific question from our last agenda, I know Cherie is here. Do you want, Cherie, do you want to, can you, I know you surfaced this at our board discussion with the Board of Supervisors. Can you tell us why the county was going to provide funding to LASA to go through an RFP process to implement additional safe parking interventions? And then the county chose not to hand money to the LASA for that process. So can you tell us what happened and why, and what's happening with that money instead?
Yes, absolutely. First, just want to acknowledge our LASA partners and how important they are for being able to get county money out to the community. We work with them all of the time on that funding stream and on the solicitations. They're often running solicitations with the county dollars. So thank you for that, and thank you. This one was a little bit atypical, a modest amount of money for safe parking from the county, and we did turn to our usual partner. Once again, thank you to help us get those dollars into each supervisorial district. Concurrently, and LASA did implement a solicitation Concurrently with that process, some of our county partners and board offices identified projects that were very much aligned with the intent of a safe parking solicitation, and were able to move forward on those projects outside of the solicitation. As a result of that, it sort of changed the scope of the solicitation. I'm going to, if there's official terms that Lawson needs to use, I'm going to let you use them and jump in because I don't want to, I know there's, you know, official terminology, but because it changed the scope of the solicitation, the change in the supervisorial interest that we were targeting and the total dollar amount of the solicitation, that did end up leading to the solicitation being canceled. However, we are still moving forward with programming those dollars into each of the supervisorial districts, including into safe parking programs, and are partnering with LASA in that regard.
Okay, so we're just maybe even spending the dollars faster. They're not going through an RFP process. They're just going directly into services.
Yep. Okay.
I think that's the presentation.
Okay, great. And we'll come back to really understand, because it's clear. Somebody called in earlier saying that they want us to be investing in safe parking solutions, and we are doing that and need to do more of it. We're very clear about that, but maybe a broader discussion for a future agenda. But given that we had this on a recent agenda, are there any questions or concerns from my colleagues?
Just to add, just so in the future that where it has the total amount of money that's the funding sources, I'd be curious as to where those funding sources per category, city general fund, minute measure H, et cetera. That'd be great.
Just, I looked over the slides earlier, and it would be great to understand what the demand is for safe parking compared to what's currently being provided. And then I think just ongoing with the theme of getting more background information, really understanding why such a large number of participants are exiting to homelessness, and then the category of other, which is really large, and just it's hard to understand what other means in this case.
Okay, so information points for our future presentation. Anything else on safe parking for now? Okay.
Commissioner Horvath, we have a speaker.
Okay, wonderful, thank you.
Ms. Peggy Kennedy, you're welcome to speak.
Thank you so much. So there's different, as you probably can imagine, there's different categories of people living in vehicles. But I think as you're going forward and looking at the safe parking possible solutions, you also have to look at who, you know, the rules. So the LASA rules are pretty, you know, strict. You have to have your driver's license. The vehicle has to be registered in your name. You need insurance. And, you know, there's things that are obstacles for certain people that could be overcome so that they could go into the safe parking easier. Like the LA City CAP program helps people with their tickets and pulls those old tickets off of the DMV hold, which, you know, makes it easier for certain people to get their vehicles registered. So, and the county doesn't have such a program. And honestly, the service providers aren't helping people get through CAP. And it would be great if more people were. So that's something. And then, you know, there's some vehicles you just can't get running. And those are the people that might be eligible, more eligible for an inside safe sort of program. In exchange for towing the vehicles and destroying them or something. And also there's so many people that you're going to, I believe there's going to have to be some tolerance on the people that aren't actually breaking other laws. And the municipalities really love putting up these oversized street signs. And then the city is putting these temporary no parking signs up with the sweeps, the Care Plus sanitation sweeps. And really all they're doing is towing the ones that don't move. And then the rest are just being
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm so sorry. Your time has expired. We do have your contact information. Is that right? So we can follow up with you directly and also make sure you are informed when we have the broader conversation, but your comments will help inform what we do next. Thank you very much. Are there any other speakers?
No, Commissioner.
We will receive and file. Moving on to item 8.
This I believe this agenda item will no longer be needed now that we have representation here. So we will discontinue this item from future agendas, but we didn't want to get rid of it for this one. Moving, unless Sharif, was there anything else you wanted to add under our city county discussion? Is there anything you wanted us to know from the county perspective while you are here?
I did want to make sure I did mention it, but I'll mention it again with everybody here, also everybody who's listening. We have begun the fiscal year 24-25 funding recommendation process for Measure H. We are in the middle right now of many community committees and stakeholder engagement processes in every service planning area with people with lived expertise, with providers, with cities and councils of government. That information is on the Homeless Initiative website, how to participate in those. We encourage broad participation. We want to get lots of input. And this helps, like, with the conversation that we're having today about aligning resources and about having flow for a system. That is what we're focusing on with this funding recommendation process. And we'd like to hear from everybody. Thank you.
And thank you for being here today. I know more meetings for all of us is hard, but I think all of us being here, we're seeing just how much is able to get done when we're all in the room together. So thank you very, very much. Item nine, I wanted to nominate Commissioner Barker as a regular member of the Programs and Contracts Committee. We have some questions, but if we are comfortable moving forward, I'd entertain a second.
Second.
Any questions or comments? If not, I will take the roll call.
Commissioner Horvath?
Aye.
Commissioner Brule?
Aye.
Commissioner Barker? Commissioner Bass?
Aye.
Commissioner Tinchella?
Aye.
Commissioner McMorrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Morrow?
Aye.
Commissioner Perez?
Aye.
Commissioner Saunders?
Aye.
The motion passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So moving on to item 10, a report on our Programs and Contracts Committee, which you will be joining. The first meeting of this newly formed committee was very successful. I think seeing how we're using funds in the context of the programs is helping us understand how we are effectively using the dollars. So I'm grateful for the combination. I know it makes it a little more complex, but I think it helps us tell the story better. And it was incredibly helpful to hear Lhasa marry the stories of finance, contracts, and programs. We're going to continue tweaking some of those reports, but we've also got some much improved reporting as well. So thank you to the staff who's working hard to make that possible. We discussed the upcoming Insight Safe RFP, certified two new agencies as qualified bidders for Lhasa funding opportunities. And we authorized the Lhasa CEO to execute master lease agreements. So lots of exciting work that's happening here. More to come at our next meeting. Item 11, do we have any commissioner updates or agenda requests for future meetings?
I just wanted to reiterate my request for the lived experience folks to come and they'll be at our next meeting.
I don't know what agenda item we have for next meeting, but it's under discussion and they are ready.
Awesome.
And they are so happy to meet with you and know you, but they want to come and visit.
We don't have a date yet.
We do not have a date yet, okay. But it is coming before the end of the year.
Can we flag that for our next internal meetings to make sure we're clear about when they're coming for that agenda discussion? Thank you.
Absolutely.
Commissioner Saunders for flagging that. Any other topics of discussion, future agenda items, things we want on the record? No. And now finally, we have three speakers in person. Do we have anybody virtually for public participation? Brenna?
No, Commissioner.
Okay, so first we'll call Andre Bueno. Good morning. We're still morning.
My name is Andre Bueno, and I'm the director of housing at Better Angels. We're a tech-driven nonprofit organization dedicated to ending homelessness in LA County. As you know, it takes 5 to 6 months to house people when they have tenant-based vouchers. I applaud your team for really effectuating moving forward with master lease. Our organization is providing funding for several private developers who are adapting, reusing structures, as well as building thousands of new permanent supportive housing units across the county. We recently engaged your unit acquisitions team with a 150-unit master lease opportunity. Though significant programmatic issues dissuaded our development partnership moving forward, we have over 1,100 units that can be delivered across the county to serve a variety of different populations by next summer. My question for you all is, how can the private market provide constructive feedback so we too can lock arms in assisting you with master leasing and bringing people inside safe?
Is there someone from our LASA staff who can answer that question? We normally don't do back and forth between, but if you can connect with this gentleman, he'll make sure to answer your question. If you have any further concerns or anything you want to elevate for us, you can let us know.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to Janet Bonsham. I'm sorry if I mispronounced your last name. Come on up. Get right up close to that mic so they can hear you, please. Welcome, Janet. Thank you.
My name is Janet Bonsham. And I'm thankful for being with us today. I'll be attending the last meeting.
Please speak up in time. It's hard to hear you.
My problem here is I'm not an individualistic person, but I've been looking for housing for almost 2 years now. I'm on and off the streets. I cannot find a house. I'm now in a shelter with one of the American volunteers. I try whether they can give me a voucher of any amount so I can add with my what I have to have what I have. To have to look for a house that I like, but I'm not having anything. Those with whom I go to make application for housing, they have housing I don't have. And we put my application, they say my money is less than the amount they want. I wait for waiting list for 5 years. I've been waiting for so long. So I'm here today, last I can help me have something that I can add on what I have to have. A place to stay. I've been looking for a place for more than 2 years. I'm homeless now. I'm in a shelter. Please. Thank for help. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jeanette. Is there someone here from LASA staff who can connect with her?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Who can I point her to specifically? Who here from LASA staff can connect with her to get information?
We'll take care of it. Just
have these right there. Thank you very much. And just want to make sure she gets connected to an actual person. Reginald Ross is our last speaker. Come on up.
Thank you for this opportunity. Real quick, welcome to Behavioral Health Services, SPY 8, and we utilize the HMIS system to input the information our clients. How does the reimagined CES affect we're the ones doing the work, getting people in? Does that affect the way we utilize the system, or do we just continue to use the survey in HMIS as a method of getting our clients in? Does it change anything?
Kiara here, maybe you can connect with Kiara. She's been navigating that with us. She can connect with you directly.
Thanks.
Very good. Thank you. Thanks for being here and getting your question answered. Nobody else online? We have one person online. Okay, one last speaker, and then.
Good morning, Suzette Shaw. Do you want to speak?
Yes, thank you so much. And I apologize earlier. I got an unexpected phone call, so I was pulled away. But I just wanted to suggest that that you all think in terms of putting these meetings, these recordings on your website so that, you know, we have something to go back to and refer to. And also, I was just going to ask, and I'm going to even suggest this for our board, our CLC board, that if you all could, you know, say your names when you're speaking, because sometimes I think I'm hearing Jessica Reed and I'm like, no, Jessica Reed is not there. So I'm trying to make out who's talking. So if you don't mind assisting me by maybe stating your names when you speak, that would really be helpful for those of us online. Thank you and have a great weekend.
Thank you very much. No other speakers. We are adjourned. We'll see you next month. Thank you very much.